declaring the end from the beginning. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Bear fruit to God, that your fruit should remain.
Shalom, harmony at home, servants of the Most High God, Yahuwah, who is rich in mercy. Because of his great love with which he loved us, he made us alive, raised us up together with HaMashiach Yahushua, and made us sit together in the heavenly places with him. Hallelujah! If we can just take a moment to really take in what Paul is quoting here in Ephesians 2 verse 6, he's saying right now, wherever you are in this course of life, you are seated in heavenly places right next to our Savior. But you're like, I'm looking around and it doesn't look much like heaven. And that's a fair question. And you will see that it probably has something to do with your perception or your understanding of heaven. Let's ponder what Jeremiah says in chapter 16, verse 19. Now, this is quite thought-provoking. And if you really think about it, it's bothersome. He says, our fathers have inherited nothing but lies. That's pretty much everything. And Jeremiah goes on and says, worthless things in which there is no profit. If that statement doesn't move you, either you need to read it again and pay extra attention, or you haven't really grasped the gravity of what he's saying. In this presentation, we're going to take what Jeremiah says and challenge our understanding of heaven. And then we will bring time and eternity into the mix. Yahuwah is ineffable and incomprehensible. And because of the richness of his great love, the scripture testifies of the great lengths he has gone through for us to get to know him. And he hid these things in plain sight and called it a mystery. But really, it's just a mist of a story. The first mention of mist is found just before the creation of Adam in Genesis 2. And it's almost like you can start from there. And the Ruach's teaching drops as the rain. The word of Yahuwah distills as the mist or the dew, as raindrops on the tender herb, and that's us, and as showers on the grass, that's all of mankind. Now, you're wondering why Yahuwah didn't just make everything plain and simple. Well, because Proverbs 25:2 says, it is the glory of Yahuwah to conceal a matter, and to search out a matter is the glory of kings. Or I understand that, or I see that as the Melchizedek priesthood. The prophet Isaiah in chapter 57 verse 15 declared Yahuwah as one who inhabits eternity. He was also inspired by the Ruach HaKodesh to include this profound statement that we all must pay attention to. He says, declaring the end from the beginning. For Yahuwah to know and declare the end from the beginning, we need to see something that is quite undeniable. Now, this is where I invite you to pause the video if you feel the need to have to go back, because this will stretch your mind as it did for me. He who inhabits eternity, that's Yahuwah, breathed his word, that's Yahushua, in the volume of the book or scroll. Now think about this. For Yahuwah to know and declare the end from the beginning, he must have already, and he has, finished and completed the storyline. And all he did was roll back from the beginning to start over. Ponder this for a moment. You have already walked. You've already experienced your future. Your life has been authored. What you're about to do, say, think has already been written in advance. So, Suzanne, are you saying that the Creator completed all things and then pressed the rewind button to hit play again? Well, that's pretty much what declaring the end from the beginning is really saying. And here is where the incomprehensible yet comprehensible love of the Father is revealing to us. Remember, Yahuwah is multidimensional beyond comprehension, who gave us his inspired scriptures, the breath of his word, Yahushua, and expressed his image in the volume of the book. That's what Psalms 40 verse 7, as well as Hebrews 10 7 says. So Yahuwah's word entered this limited dimensional realm. And when you receive the word of Yahuwah and he dwells richly in you, we as finite beings can hear and see the infinite word. And so we can get insight to the unfolding of the past, present, and future events all at once. So another way of putting it, we get inside information so we can run the course of life all together as victors. You see, by Yahuwah declaring the end from the beginning, he is inviting, he is extending an invitation to travel and go outside of time. Yahushua gives us the ability to travel time, if you think about it, through the word of his scripture. No matter what point of time you entered this dimension, in HaMashiach, you have an opportunity to look back in time, learn from past lessons, and get advanced comprehension to today's lesson plans. And so our present trials and testings can lead us towards the path for future lessons designed to progress us into graduating well this course of life with honors, should you desire to. Paul says in Ephesians 2:7 that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in HaMashiach Yahusha. Do a little bit of digging on the Greek definition of the phrase ages to come. You'll end up with eternity future. Again, it's like an invitation to go outside of time. And by the way, this is not just a future thing. Paul is referring to present time. In verse 2 of the same chapter, the word ages or aeon, Strong's G165, also means a period of time. But notice how Paul uses this same Greek word, aeon, in the phrase course of this world, Strong's G2889, cosmos, which is defined also as the circle of the earth. Now, when I think of circles, I think of cycles. So in a sense, Paul is speaking about the world affairs and how it runs its courses in cycles of time. If you love to study history, you would have observed that history simply repeats itself and that there are lessons to be drawn from history. And here's a quote from Aldous Huxley. He says that men do not learn very much from the lessons of history is the most important of all the lessons of history. Hear from the wisdom of King Solomon in Ecclesiastes 3:11. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts. The word beautiful in Hebrew, Strong's H3303, yafeh, meaning fair, beautiful, handsome. And so now I want to make a connection with what Paul wrote in Romans 12:2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of Yahuwah. So the Father has a good and acceptable and perfect will. And it also has something to do with the renewing of the mind. Going back to Ecclesiastes 3:11, it states that everything is beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts. So I am making a connection between time, eternity, and the good, acceptable, and perfect will of the Father And let me explain as to why. But first, let's just establish something that is clear here. Since you have a heart and are listening to this, you are qualified in that you have been given eternity in your heart. I believe that the perfect will of the Father is for us to walk in eternity here on earth. Both Matthew and Luke speaks of this in their letters. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So you can be experiencing heaven now, right this present time, to learn how to walk by faith. And see that He has given us eternity in our hearts. I want to connect time with what Paul is saying when it comes to the will of the Father. Remember, Solomon is saying time is beautiful or fair in Hebrew. However, I see this qualify as only the good and acceptable will of the Father. There is yet a perfect will. Back to Romans 12, verse 2, Paul says, "Do not be conformed to this world." The Greek word behind conform, G4964, souskematizo, which means to conform one's self, one's mind and character to another's pattern, or fashion oneself according to. What particular pattern? Time. Time is one thing that every single man, woman, child on this earth is conforming to, fashioning ourselves in accordance to time. And so Paul says, do not be conformed to this world. World in Greek is aeon, G165, which means a period of time or age. So Paul essentially is saying, do not be conformed to time. And this makes sense because we know that we are all bound to time. This world is passing away. Time is passing away also. A good question at this point then would be, what must one do to be not conformed to this world or this period of time? Paul goes on and tells us the how-to. And that is by being transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of Yahuwah. Note that there is a perfect will, and it has something to do with the renewing of the mind. So time can make things beautiful, but this is only the Father's good and acceptable will. The perfect will of the Father is the latter part of that verse, that He has given us eternity in our hearts. And note that Paul makes the connection with our transformation in this world by the renewing of our mind. So all of that to say this. Time is simply a state of one's mind. Time, as we understand today, is but an illusion. And that is because time is determined by our state of mind, state of our mood or our being. Ever wonder why perception of time changes based on the mood of your mind, the mood you're in? Notice how time goes by faster when you're having fun. But when you're bored or anticipating something, time seems to drag long. Why is it on the way to a destination and in anticipation, time seems really slow? Notice how after the experience of that destination, and now you're traveling back, and in reflection, time seems to go by faster. So in other words, time goes by fast when you're having fun. And time seems to drag really slow when you're simply bored. So what is time like for you when you are in prayer? Is time never enough when you are spending time with the people of Yahuwah? Does it seem like there's no concept of time when you're enjoying your fellowship with like-minded believers? How's your state of mind when you're studying the word of Yahuwah? Do you look forward to the next chance you get to curl up in your comfy chair and immerse your mind in the word? Or do you find you're easily distracted? Do you feel what Solomon says in Ecclesiastes 12:12, where he says, "Much study wearies the body"? Or do you feel energized after being charged by the word of Yahuwah? When you're reading your Bibles, do you feel like you're outside looking in? Kind of like you're reading, but you can't hear the word. It's almost as if there's a wall or a partition in between that limits your hearing. I think the mystery behind this illusion of time doesn't really exist for those who know how to exit time and enter into eternity given to us in our hearts. So the question is, can you exit time? Can we really enter eternity now? And since Yahuwah is outside of time, is it possible to have heaven on earth? Heaven is where time is non-existence. So is it possible to have heaven here on earth? Now remember, at one point in the Garden of Eden, which is an enclosed, set-apart place, mankind inhabited eternity with the Creator. And we'll talk more about this at the next presentation. But understand that after the fall, the whole world became subjected to time. And that is why time itself needs redeeming. Now, John says that the word of Yah became flesh and dwelt among us. Think of eternity entering time. Yahuwah's word, the son of Yahuwah, who is from above, representing eternity, entered time, entered this flesh and blood representing time, so that through Yahushua, who is the door, the way to the truth that leads us to eternal life, through him, eternity can once again inhabit us. May your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That sounds like the Garden of Eden to me, heaven on earth. Now, 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, "Do you not know that you are the temple of Yahuwah and that the Spirit of God dwells in you?" What happens when the Messiah richly dwells in our hearts, inside our living tabernacles? Ephesians 3:17 says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. When we get rooted and grounded in love, then we become like the trees Psalms 1:3 speaks about. We shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. We are literally walking, talking, mini representation of Yahuwah's righteousness on earth. And you will see that we actually usher the redemption or the renewal that is forthcoming in this world. Creation itself eagerly waits the revealing of the sons and the daughters of the Most High. Romans 8:19 speaks about that. So how do we reveal Messiah in us? Now let's trace back from the seed of the woman in the garden. Yahushua came in the flesh. That's inside us. The seed germinates by the watering of the word, by the light of his countenance. And then Isaiah 55:10 says the rain and the snow come down from the heavens and stay on the ground to water the earth. They cause the grain to grow, producing seed for the farmer and bread for the hungry. The fruit of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit that we bear as sons and daughters of the Most High, is the precursor to the release from bondage of corruption that the rest of creation was subjected to. Then the glorification and liberty of the children of Yahuwah comes, and eternity will once again inhabit the earth. The kingdom of Yahuwah reestablished here on earth, better than what it was in the beginning. Now at this point, you might be asking, so does that mean everything has been predestined? Where does free will come into play? Now, the definition of free will changes outside of time. In eternity, there is freedom. We truly are free to express our true selves in the perfect will of the Father in the Garden of Delight or Garden of Eden or the kingdom to come. Yes, we have free will to the extent of the parameters established by Yahuwah in his kingdom. You and I are too precious in his sight for Yahuwah to just let us go boundless and limitless. It is really for our own good. But if you're asking specifically about our freedom to choose now in this time-bound dimension, This is where Deuteronomy 30 verse 19 enters the stage. Moses is the spokesperson for Yahuwah, and he says, "This day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life so that you and your children may live." Remember, this is after the sin of the golden calf. And so this setting takes place after the giving of the book of the law, which is different from the book of covenant. If you didn't understand what I just said, I would direct you to Matthew Nolan's teachings on the book of covenant versus book of the law, which will give you some very good insights and enlightenment in this very important distinction that you need to be made aware of. But going back to my point, Moses set before the children of Israel to choose between life and death, and then he begged them to choose life. So at this point, they are on timeout, if you think about it, because they broke the covenant that Yahuwah established for them in Exodus 19. So instead of being a nation of priests, they became a nation with a priest, until HaMashiach does away with the Aaronic priesthood. Now, this is a good example as to what freedom to choose is like in this time-bound dimension. Yahuwah being multidimensional, incomprehensible, nothing limits him. He has somehow set in this temporal course of life all the possibilities of your choosing. So when we choose life, we are blessed. And all of the events associated with that choice has been prepared in advance. The choosing determines which events is pulled out of the shelf to add to the pages of our personal history book on life. But when we choose death, a lot of times from our vantage point, it is hard to see that we've chosen the path leading to death because we've inherited lies and much of the truth is suppressed in this world today. But this is why there are curses attached to the choice we make when we choose wrong. This is how we know we've chosen the wrong path. And so when we face the consequences of our poor choices, it's like a reset button is pressed and we are put in a position that we have to be still. And so we can start to know the good, acceptable, and perfect will of Yahuwah, and so that we can choose right. And again, how loving is it that the Creator has given us instructions by the Most High to help us get it right the first time, also known as the Torah or the Law of God. So the Torah for us in this dimension is really a gift of navigation from the Almighty El Shaddai, and how we need this in this dark world, and all of which is designed so that we can be led back to the path of righteousness. In the next presentation, we will take a closer look at what it's like in the Garden of Eden, in this enclosure that the Most High has set apart from the rest of the world. Until then, be still and know.
The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you.